बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। इन दिस वीडियो वी विल टॉक अबाउट टीबिया। टीबिया इज़ ए मीडियल एंड लार्जर बोन ऑफ द लेग एंड इट इज़ होमोलोगस विद द रेडियस ऑफ अपर लिम्ब। टीबिया इज़ ए टिपिकल लॉन्ग बोन हैविंग एन अपर एंड एन इंटरवेनिंग शाफ्ट एंड अ लोअर एंड। टू डिटरमिन साइड ऑफ टीबिया वी हैव टू लुक अबाउट थ्री सिंपल पॉइंट्स। नंबर वन, द अपर एंड शुड बी मोर एक्सपेंडेड ऑन साइड वाइज एज कम्पेयर्ड विद द लोअर एंड, while the lower end, number two, the lower end on its medial side should show a projection known as medial malleolus, this one, while the anterior border of the bone should show a sinuously curved anterior margin, you can see. So keeping these three points in mind, we can determine that this is a left-sided tibia bone. Now coming towards the general features. First, we will discuss upper end. Upper end is composed of medial condyle, lateral condyle, and intercondylar area, and a tibial tuberosity on the anterior side. Now, medial condyle. The medial condyle is articular on its superior aspect, which articulates with the medial condyle of femur to form a part of the knee joint, and its central part, the articular surface in its central part is concave and comes in contact directly with the femoral condyle, while on its periphery it is flanked by the presence of medial meniscus of knee joint. Laterally, this articular surface is covering the medial intercondylar tubercle. The anterior and medial side of this medial condyle, anterior and medial surfaces of this medial condyle has various vascular foramina, you can see, while on the posterior side this medial condyle is showing a groove. Coming towards the lateral condyle. Lateral condyle is also articular on its superior aspect with the lateral condyle of the femur and also take part in forming the knee joint. The articular surface in its central part is also concave and comes in direct contact with the lateral condyle of femur, while on its periphery it is flanked by the presence of lateral meniscus of knee joint, this one. And on its medial aspect it is covering the lateral intercondylar tubercle. The anterior aspect of this lateral condyle shows it flattened impression known as Gerdes tubercle, while on its posterior aspect this lateral condyle shows a fibular facet which is flat and small circular facet for the head of the fibula to form the superior tibia fibular joint, and this facet is directed downwards, backwards and laterally. And posterior superior to this facet we have a groove here which is lodging the tendon of popliteus. Now coming towards the intercondylar area, this one. The intercondylar area is actually a roughened area present between two articular areas of two condyles. It is narrowest in the middle, while on the anterior and posterior aspect it is wider. And in its middle, it is elevated to form the intercondylar eminence, which is flanked by the presence of lateral and medial menisci. Lateral and medial intercondylar tubercle. Now the general features about tuberosity. What is tibial tuberosity? Tibial tuberosity is actually a prominence located on the upper anterior side of the upper end of tibia, and it is divided into two parts, the upper smooth part and the lower rough part. The upper smooth part has got the attachment of ligamentum patellae, while the lower rough subcutaneous part is separated from skin by subcutaneous infrapatellar bursa. Now coming towards the shaft of tibia is prismoid in shape, meaning that it has three surfaces and three borders. We will discuss borders first. This is the anterior border. This anterior border starts from the inferior aspect of tibial tuberosity and continues downward as a sinuously curved border, being convex medially in the upper part and convex laterally in the lower part, and ends at the anterior border of the medial malleolus. Now coming to us, the medial border. This is the medial border, which starts from the medial condyle and continues downward as a rounded border and ends at the posterior border of medial malleolus. Now coming towards the lateral border. The lateral border is also known as the introitus border because it provides attachment to the introitus membrane, and it starts just below of the fibular facet and continues downward like this and ends at the anterior margin of the fibular notch at the lower end of the tibia. So these are the borders. Now coming towards the surfaces. Surfaces of tibia are medial surface, this one, the lateral surface, and the posterior surface. The medial surface, this one, is lying between the anterior and medial borders, and the most of this surface is subcutaneous. This whole surface is subcutaneous in a living subject. Now coming towards the lateral surface, this one, this lateral surface is present between the anterior and the interosseous borders, and in its upper part it is directed on the lateral side, while in its lower part it is twisted to come on to the anterior side of the bone. You can see like this, it is twisted and appears on the anterior side of the bone. Now coming towards the posterior surface, this one is the posterior surface which is lying between the medial and interosseous borders. It is widest in its upper two-thirds, this one, and here it is crossed by an oblique ridge known as solial line. You can see this one is the solial line which is starting from the fibular facet and continues downward and ends at this medial border. The posterior border for surface above solial line is in the form of triangular area, while below this solar line it is elongated and is divided by a vertical ridge, this one, into a lateral area and a medial area. So these are the general features of the shaft. Now for lower end, this one is the lower end of tibia, which has got five surfaces and a projection known as medial malleolus. This is the medial malleolus, which is a projection projecting downwards from the medial side of the bone, this one, and it takes part in forming the mortise of the ankle joint. Now the five surfaces of lower end are as follows. This one is the anterior surface, which is smooth in its upper part while rough in its lower part. Similarly, the posterior surface is smooth in its upper part while rough in its lower part, but is smaller as compared with the larger anterior surface. Now coming towards the medial surface of lower end is continuous below with the medial surface of medial malleolus and is subcutaneous, while the lateral surface of lower end presents a triangular fibular notch, this one, which is rough in its upper part and takes part in forming the inferior tibiofibular joint, while in lower part it is smooth and is covered with hyaline cartilage of ankle joint. The last surface is the inferior surface, this one, which is articular and articulates with the superior trochlear surface of talus and takes part in forming the part of the ankle joint. This articular surface is also lodging onto the part of the medial malleolus. So these are all about the general features of tibia. Now coming towards the attachments. Tibia has got various attachments. We will discuss one by one. First of all, on the medial malleolus. Three attachments are on medial malleolus. The upper margin of this medial malleolus provide attachment to capsule of knee joint and also to the tibial collateral ligament. And the other attachment is of the semimembranosus, which is inserted onto the groove on posterior side of this medial malleolus, medial condyle. Now the attachments on lateral condyle. The lateral condyle on its anterior aspect on Gerdy's tubercle provides attachment to iliotibial tract, while on the margins of fibular facet there is attachment of capsule of superior tibiofibular joint, and here this groove is lodged by the tendon of popliteus with a bursa intervening between the bone and the tendon. Now coming to the attachments on the intercondyle area. This is intercondyle area. From before backwards we will discuss six attachments. Number one, there is the attachment of anterior horn of medial meniscus of knee joint. Then there is the attachment of anterior cruciate ligament, anterior horn of lateral meniscus, and then in the posterior part we have got the attachment of posterior horn of lateral meniscus, posterior horn of medial meniscus, and last is posterior cruciate ligament, which is on the posterior most part of the bone. So six attachments are on this intercondylar area. Now the attachments on tibial tuberosity, I have discussed it already. It is providing attachment to the ligamentum patellae in its upper smooth part, while the lower rough subcutaneous part is separated from skin by subcutaneous infrapatellar bursa. Now coming towards the attachments on the shaft, the anterior border, this one, is providing attachment to the deep fascia of the leg, while in its lower part it is providing attachment to the superior extensor retinaculum. Similarly, this medial border is also providing attachment to the medial deep fascia of the leg, while the interosseous border, this one, is providing attachment to the interosseous membrane. Now the attachments on the surfaces of shaft of femur, tibia. The lateral surface, this one, is providing attachment to the tibialis anterior in its upper two-thirds, while the medial surface is subcutaneous in whole extent, while its upper part, this one, is providing insertion to three muscles which are known as gyri ropes and stabilize the pelvis. From before backwards you can name them as sartorius, gracilis, semitendinosus, and behind these three attachments there is attachment of tibial collateral ligament along the medial border. Now coming towards the attachments on the posterior surface. The solian line is providing attachment to the soleus muscle, and it also provides attachment to fascia covering soleus, fascia covering popliteus, and also to the superficial transverse fascial septum. And the standinous soleal arch for origin of soleus is also attached to the solian line. The triangular area above soleal line is providing insertion to the popliteus muscle, while the lateral area below soleal line is providing origin to the tibialis posterior, while the medial area below soleal line is providing origin to the flexor digitorum longus. So these are attachments on the shaft. Now for the lower end, the fibular notch in its upper part here provides attachment to the interosseous tibiofibular joint, while the lower part is smooth and covered with hyaline cartilage, while the margin of the articular surface of inferior surface of lower end is providing attachment to the capsule of ankle joint, while the lower end of this medial malleolus is providing attachment to the deltoid ligament. So these are all about attachments and general features. Now the relations of lower end of tibia. The anterior surface is crossed from medial to lateral side by six structures, which we can remember by a mnemonic TDEP or acronym TDEP. TEATDEPDEP. Number one is tibialis anterior. Then we have extensor hallucis longus. Then anterior tibial artery. Then the deep peroneal nerve, extensor digitorum longus, and the last one is peroneus tertius. Similarly, for the posterior side of the lower end, we have got five structures from medial to lateral side, which we can remember by an acronym TFPTF. The first one is tibialis posterior, flexor digitorum longus, posterior tibial arteries or vessels. Then we have tibial nerve, and the last one is flexor hallucis longus. And also the lower end of medial surface is crossed by great saphenous vein along with saphenous nerve here. So these are the three relations of lower end of tibia. So the nutrient artery of tibia is a branch of the posterior tibial artery, which is the largest nutrient artery of the body, and the nutrient foramen is located near the vertical ridge on posterior surface and is directed downward, you can see. So the upper end of tibia is a growing end. So the upper end is growing end. So that's all about the general features and attachments of tibia. Thanks for watching.